chest polish. Well, hello everybody! I am back from my nice little vacation during the weekend. Four wonderful days spent in New York and New Jersey doing various different things, and I have to say that that was, honest to God, one of the best weekends of my life. That was just a great deal of fun. All weekend long, all kinds of great things to do, both wrestling and non-wrestling related. It was truly rich and worthwhile experience all around, and I really enjoyed myself. So overall, that was a trip well spent, and man, I've got the itch to go back there pretty soon, especially, you know, the Giants playing at MetLife Stadium. I'm like, man, I gotta go back there and see the Giants play, or I might even go to the Super Bowl next year, who knows. We'll see how that plays out, but yeah, awesome weekend. I had a lot of fun all weekend long. It was great, wonderful, and I'm a really happy guy right now, overall. Going over the weekend, obviously the two major things I need to talk about for you guys are Ring of Honor, Supercard of Honor 7, which I saw Friday night. And this show that you may have heard of called Wrestlemania, yeah, 29, saw that Sunday night. So, yeah, I got to talk about that as well. I'm going to sprinkle in some Raw discussion in there as well, because I have to talk about that episode of Raw, too. You know, it was funny. I actually, I took the bus up to New York and back to New York, to Maryland, which was cheaper and fine. The ride back wasn't as much fun, but overall it was... Yeah, it was a nice mode of transportation, but I didn't get back. I didn't get back home until about 11 o'clock on Monday night, and the first message I got, I got a call from a friend of mine. And he was like, "Dude, did you see Raw?" And I'm like, "No, I just walked in the door." And he was like, "Dude, that crowd was on fucking crack, or they sprayed with them with laughing gas or some shit because they were acting bonkers." I'm like, "What? I've got to see this." So I finally watched. I'm filming this after I watched Raw, and I was like, "Holy shit, that is hilarious. That crowd was awesome." And you know, most of them had to have been at Mania the night before, so I'm kind of like, man, I wish I'd stuck around for Raw. But, you know, because in case you don't know, the Izod Center, or whatever the arena is, that Raw was held in, is literally within walking distance of MetLife Stadium. I think, if memory serves me right, it's just on the other side of the tracks. Well, you have the train that takes you to and from the arena, and I think the Izod Center is on the other side of the tracks from where MetLife Stadium is. So you know a lot of the same people that were in the crowd for Raw had been at WrestleMania the night before. So yeah, I'm going to sprinkle in Raw discussion as I talk about WrestleMania, just to kind of fill in the blanks of how I felt during WrestleMania and how they followed up on it the next night on Raw. So that's going to be how I address that. But yeah, kudos to that crowd on Raw. They were fucking amazing. Da 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 da. That has been stuck in my head for the last like 6 hours ever since I watched Raw. It's just, oh my god, this is fucking great. But yeah, let's get started. Came in on Friday at noon. We hung around for a bit. Met up with my buddy Eric, who planned the whole weekend. It was kudos to him for making this whole thing happen. It was great. And we got to the Ring of Honor show Friday night. I forgot my camera. I was really pissed off about that. I was like, man, Because I was going to take pictures and everything at the Ring of Honor show, and you probably would have seen some of those pictures at the start of this video. But, whatever, we get there, the show was in Hammerstein, I'd never been there before, so that was awesome to sit in that venue, the Hammerstein Ballroom, for a wrestling event. I was like, wow, that's really awesome. And I gotta be honest, Ring of Honor, man, they brought their A-game for this pay-per-view. It was an awesome event, I thought. I mean, they really worked hard out there to put on the best show possible. And I thought they did a bang-up job, at least with the in-ring product, of putting on an excellent show. And I hadn't followed Ring of Honor storylines for a while now. But there was an opening video for the pay-per-view that they showed us that kind of brought us up to speed at least a little bit. And everything else I was able to follow at least pretty well. And I knew who most of the guys were. So there wasn't much of a problem as far as that goes. I was able to catch on pretty quick to what was going on. So we get started. Well, before the pay-per-view started, we had a dark match. It was two guys I've never heard of before. Konga, who's basically like a big fat guy imitating Umaga. He was like a native gimmick. And he was facing somebody named Corey Hollis or... something like that. I think his name is Corey Hollis. Kind of looked like AJ Styles, at least in appearance. And they went out there and had this very basic big guy versus little guy match, but the crowd completely shit on them. I have to say, that crowd was very lively and very energetic throughout the night. Even though there was a guy behind me who kept yelling in French the whole night. He must have been from France. And it was so weird to hear him talk and yell stuff the whole night. Je suis, and that's a horrible French accent, but he would just say some French phrase, and then, Kevin Steen? And it was that all night long. It's like, I know he's not from here, but I just want to punch him in the face because it's getting annoying. But at the back of our section, there was a guy that was screaming awesome shit all night. Like, he had one-liner after one-liner throughout the entire show. I was like, I want to meet that guy. He's fucking awesome. But anyway, we had this match. It was Konga versus Corey Hollis or Hellas or whatever the fuck his name was. And they had like this very basic big guy versus little guy match, but they kept chanting, "You can't wrestle." I'm assuming it was directed at the fat guy, at Konga. And I'm like, what are they doing wrong? It's a basic match. I mean, what are you doing? But this crowd was merciless, to say the least. And I'll get into that a little bit later. But they were very energetic throughout the night. And once the pay-per-view started, they never let up. I mean, they were just on fire all night and chanting shit. We opened up the show with R.D. Evans and his mystery partner versus ACH and Tavares Thompson. I think that's his name. Tavares Thompson. I'm sure I fucked that up. Somebody will correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm basing this all off of memory, and I'm doing this entire video in one take, so you're going to listen to me babble for about an hour as I'm trying to recollect and recall everything, so get ready for the long haul. But that was the opening match, and it was a pretty good hot match. I thought ACH and Tavares were a really good tag team, like a good athletic tag team, and QT Marshall was hilarious. I mean, he was like the manager type. And he stood in as the mystery partner, but him building up who the mystery partner was going to be before he revealed it to be himself was hilarious. He had, like, this awesome bit down. I was like, man, that's some good wrestling comedy right there, and a good use of, I assume he's a manager, even though he's athletic. I assume that's what his role was all along, and I was like, man, this guy's awesome. And great mouthpiece, great on the mic, and I really, I was like, man, wrestling business needs more managers like QT Marshall. That guy was awesome. That guy was really, really entertaining. So I really enjoyed the opener. The second match, it was supposed to be Shelton Benjamin versus Charlie Haas, but the whole incident with Charlie Haas at the ROH DVD tapings, which I heard about that, nixed that match. So Shelton Benjamin came out and started talking on the mic and really seemed to drone on and on, and I was like, whose idea was it to give Shelton Benjamin a mic? He looked awesome. I was amazed. Shelton's in really, really good shape, and looks great physically, but, you know, his Achilles heel has always been on the mic. He's terrible on the mic, and I was like, man, shut up. You know, he just kept going on and on and on. And that brought out the prodigy, Mike Bennett, with Maria, and they made it sound like Bennett was making his return at the show, like he'd been gone for a while, I guess to an injury or something. So I'm sure for the Ring of Honor fans who followed the storylines, that was a huge surprise to have him come out. And Maria was hot as hell in person, gotta say that. She looked very, very nice. And the match itself was seemed a little off. It wasn't bad. It just it didn't really flow all that well. I'm not that impressed with Mike Bennett. I just kind of he doesn't leave much of an impression on me. I was actually this is gonna sound really sad. I think the person I was most impressed with during the match was Maria. She took this super kick spot. I was like, holy shit, she can bump and actually do shit and make it look good. And that kick she took looked nasty. So I was like, that was the spot of the match that I really remember. But it was an okay match overall, and Bennett got the win, and they made it sound like Shelton was going to be going, if you follow the internet rumors, he's going to the WWE for another run. He looks like he's in shape for it, so good for him, and hopefully we do see him in the WWE at some point, and hopefully he's able to make something good of it. He's still athletic and still very good, so, there's something to work with there with Shelton, absolutely, so I wouldn't be surprised if he popped up in WWE again. Then the third match was my favorite match of the night. Jay Lethal versus Mike Elgin, or is it Elgin or Elgin? Because I've heard it both ways, and I feel like I'm getting it wrong. But I say Elgin because I think it sounds better, but it's like Godzilla movies. Is it, Godzilla versus Megaguirus? Is it Megaguirus? Is it Megaguirus? Is it Megagyrus? I've heard like 12 different pronunciations for that fucking monster's name. But, anyway, it's Jay Lethal versus Mike Elgin, and the crowd was awesome for this match. The match was amazing itself, and I gotta be honest, the first time I saw Elgin, I thought he was really green, and he was just kind of just a typical muscle head that they throw out there because he's strong, but he's really not that great. He looked like a star in this match. I was like, wow, he's really come a long way since the last time I saw him, which was, granted, I mean, that was like a year and a half ago, but he looked awesome in this match. It was a great clashing of styles between him and Lethal. And by the time this match was over, it was like, yeah, the winner of this match deserves to be number one contender, because it was just that awesome of a match. And I loved it. I really enjoyed it. And after the match was over, I was just kind of like, good luck following that. Fortunately, Ring of Honor was smart and had an intermission right after the 10-man tag, so I think that really allowed the crowd to really cool itself down a little bit after that match, because that match was just too fucking good. That match was great. And that was my match of the night. My second favorite match of the weekend, which we'll get into my favorite one later, but then we got into the 10-man tag, ROH versus SCUM. Which I hadn't followed any of the SCUM storyline, but like I said, the video package at the beginning really helped bring me up to speed at least a little bit, enough to get what was going on. The match was, it was kind of clusterfucky, I thought. The brawl outside the ring was, seemed to go on a little too long, and I didn't know, for some reason, I didn't know if it was going to be a street fight, it was going to be no tagging, it was just straight up tornado tag street fight. Or if it was just going to boil down into a regular match, which it eventually did boil down into a regular match. I was kind of confused by it, and I thought the match was kind of, like I said, it was kind of clusterfuck. It wasn't awful, it was just kind of, they hit a couple cool spots here and there, and that was it. SCUM got the win, and that's fine to set up what they were going to do in the main event, so that was all cool. Then we got the intermission, and that was much needed, because we needed to, catch ourselves up and kind of calm down. Because that Lethal Elgin match really was killer. I can't put that match over enough. That match was really, really strong. Speaking of strong, we come into Roderick Strong versus Machine Gun Karl Anderson. Roderick Strong continues to be the most unimpressive internet darling ever. I'm sorry. I don't see it in this guy. I've never seen it. I've never been impressed with him. I've never liked his work in ROH. I didn't like him when he was in TNA. I didn't like him when he returned to ROH. I haven't liked any of his indie work. And I've seen him live now. This is the first time I've seen him live. And I watched him like, he's not that good. It's not that he's terrible. It's just that he's ordinary. Everything about him is ordinary. And my friend Eric was making jokes. It's like, hey, you want to see AJ Styles with a less impressive look, less than half the charisma, and almost none of the interesting moves? Check out Roderick Strong, and that's who you got. And that's basically it. He's just a guy. He looks like the typical indie guy. Just a, like, good athlete, good enough athlete, but nothing about him stands out or really sets him apart from anybody else. He has no star quality to him at all whatsoever. I've said a lot of the same things about Wade Barrett, and I think Barrett is more of a star than Roderick Strong is, to be perfectly honest. And the match he had with Anderson, it was just... That one, more than any other match, just felt like an indie match. It just felt like two guys that don't belong on TV that are, that you know, just having a match. And, you know, I wasn't that invested in it, to be perfectly honest, but the crowd loved Roderick Strong. I don't get it. The internet, they pick their favorites, and that's one that I've never understood. I've never seen the appeal in Roderick Strong. I mean, I remember when people were telling me he was on par with Austin Aries, and I was, for the longest time, I was not impressed with Austin Aries. It wasn't until, and again, not that Aries was ever a bad athlete or a bad worker or anything. It was just that I never saw a star quality in him. It wasn't until his recent run in TNA that I really was kind of admitted I was wrong. But Roderick, I mean, I've seen the guy live now, and the guy can't cut a promo worth shit. And I just didn't care for him. But the crowd, they loved him, so I could have seen him. And the crowd, I put them over for being very lively and energetic, and they were awesome all night. But some of the things they chanted were a little weird. They chanted... Okay, like Konga in the opening match, the obvious thing to chant would have been Umaga, because that's obviously who he was basing himself off of. But they were chanting Funkasaurus, and I'm like, no, he's Umaga. I mean, that's who. If you're gonna make fun of him for ripping off somebody, choose the right guy. He was ripping off Umaga. And then they started chanting like things like gutter slut at Maria, which granted that was set up by Shelton in the early promo, but. It was like, how is she a gutter slut? Or sloppy seconds and shit. It's like, she dated CM Punk. They had sex, as most couples do that are in relationships. That relationship ended, and now she's sleeping with somebody else that she's in a relationship with. How does that make her a gutter slut? The morality in wrestling. It's sort of like some of the stuff that WWE's done with AJ, where it's like, they try to paint her as like this loose, slutty character. I'm like, not really. I mean, that's not a slut. She just had a bunch of bad relationships and picked wrong people that treated her poorly, like John Cena, and she moved on to somebody else after those people treated her bad. That's how I see it anyway, but hey, that's just me. So, no, I don't think Maria's a gutter slut. They were chanting "We want wrestling" during some of the opening promos, which I was kind of like, okay, look, guys, be patient. They're setting up a match here, and I trust me, I really enjoyed QT Marshall's opening bit. So I was like, you know, that's fine. I don't mind that we didn't get action right off the bat because that bit was entertaining. And but yeah, that's where and the crowd was awesome all night. But I did disagree with them on a couple of things, and those are just some examples. But and their love, their undying love for Roderick Strong, that I will never understand because apparently I'm stupid. I'm the dumb one because I'm in the minority, I guess. But then we moved on to, and now this is one where I was totally along with the crowd. The TV title match. It was I'm slipping on his name here. Mike Taver, the television champion, defending against Adam Cole and Matt fucking Hardy. This is where the live experience is really totally different from watching it on pay-per-view. I'm sure watching it on pay-per-view, it probably wasn't that impressive of a match. But being there live, it was actually my favorite part of the show. Because we got to make fun of Matt Hardy and hurt his feelings. And we were so cruel. We were so mean. Chanting, you fat fuck. And basically just making fun of him for being fat. And he was fat. And I'm not saying I'm the most athletic guy in the world or I have the best physique. I've got a gut too, but I don't do this for a living. And it's like, dude, this is your job. Would it kill you to do some sit-ups? I'm just saying, you know, and it's like for you to come in that kind of shape, I think is kind of sad. I was just looking at him, I was like, dude, it's called a fucking treadmill. Get on one. It's your job. And he looked awful. So of course we made fun of him to no end. And Eric sitting next to me got a lot of laughs in our section. He made a great call when Hardy was setting up for the Twist of Fate. Eric said, "Oh my God, he's gonna eat him." And that got a lot of laughs in our section. So, we had a lot of fun at Matt Hardy's expense. But I have to say, though, it's Matt Taver or Mike Taver. I'm sorry, I keep slipping on the names. I'm sorry, I'm not completely familiar with all these guys yet. But I really liked his look, and I thought he showed some stuff. And I was like, man, guy's pretty good. It's kind of like what John Morrison should have been. John Morrison, great athlete, great worker, WWE presented him like a goofball. And, like, everything about John Morrison was great, except for his character, which the WWE gave him by, you know, having him say stupid, pandering bullshit that he never should have come out of his mouth. But Taver, really, he was basically like what John Morrison should have been. Great athlete, good worker. I don't know if he's good on the mic. He had Truth Martini speaking for him, which is fine. Again, managers are good. And great look, great presentation all around. I was like, wow, that guy is, I think they've got something with that guy. I like him. Of course, you know, he's simulated ass-fucking his girlfriend, who I didn't catch her name, but... simulated ass-fucking her, you know, as part of his entrance. So, naturally, I thought, okay, that guy's kind of awesome. yeah, really had a lot of fun during that match. Then we had the tag title match between reDragon and the American Wolves, and, there were a few miscues in the early goings, and I was like, ugh, they're kind of messing up a little bit here. But as the match got going, it became an awesome tag team match, and it actually became a debate between Eric and I, which match we liked more, Lethal Elgin or the tag match. He liked the tag match more, I liked Lethal Elgin more. But that just shows how good the match was. It was a very, very good tag match, and it's just so nice. It's like, oh, a tag match with great tag team action. Hooray! We don't get that nearly enough. But, yeah, damn good match. The American Wolves are great. They're basically a modern-day version of the British Bulldogs in a lot of ways. It's a lot of the same presentation, actually, and they're great. And reDragon, this is the first time I've ever seen them as a team. I've seen O'Reilly before, but that's the first time I've ever seen reDragon as a team, and they look pretty good too, so it was nice to see just two really good tag teams coming together and having a really good match, and great tag team match. I was like, wow, that was a damn good one, so another great match at this Ring of Honor event. And then we get to the main event, which was Kevin Steen defending the title against Jay Briscoe, which was great. Just for the ending, because I was not expecting a title change. When the TV title didn't change hands and when the tag title didn't change hands, it put the idea, maybe Jay's going to win the belt, because I figured they'd want to do at least one title change on a big show like this. But it was still a shock. I was like, oh my god, Jay Briscoe won the title, and it was cool. I got to see a world title change at a pay-per-view. That I'm attending, and it really felt like a huge ending to the show, and fans were totally into it, really excited for the finish, and I think they were legit shocked by it as well. I thought that they were setting up Elgin to face Kevin Steen, and that was going to be their big match, the two big guys having a world title match, and that would have been great. I'd still be up for seeing that match, but it was a really exciting closer to the show. Now, here's where the problem comes in. I didn't know this while I was in attendance, obviously, but the stream died during the main event, apparently, and people missed the finish. And it's just another example of Ring of Honor not being able to put on those iPay-per-views for whatever reason. They always run into problems. And the last time I commented on this, people... kind of came on, not, they didn't yell at me or anything, but they said, no, they've gotten better, they fixed it, and they've gotten better with presenting those now. And now, I'm there at this show, and they have a huge problem with the stream where people miss the finish to the main event. WCW did that, and I remember Halloween Havoc, we remember that whole disaster where Goldberg and DDP, the show ran long, and Goldberg and DDP got cut, and everybody, the pay-per-view audience completely missed the match. That's what this is like. It's like one of those like major fuck-ups, and I don't know why. I don't know what it is. Every time I'm associated where I'm trying to view a Ring of Honor pay-per-view, something fucks up with the stream, and it's just, I'm just lucky that this time I was actually in attendance rather than watching it on my computer, so I didn't have the misfortune of being pissed off about it or being negatively impacted by it. And it's a shame, too, because the ending was really well executed and awesome. And a great way to close the show. And, you know, overall, I thought Ring of Honor really brought their A-game to this pay-per-view. I thought it was a very strong iPay-per-view from them and a strong effort all around. Eric was telling me the next day, it's like, you know, man, I've been watching wrestling a long time, and I saw at least 18 moves in that show that I'd never seen before, and that's the kind of effort that they bring. They bring great athleticism and great action to create the best in-ring product possible. And that's always been Ring of Honor's identity, through the highs and the lows. They will always bring it in the ring and try to deliver the best athletic product possible. And they, I felt like they definitely achieved that at Supercard of Honor 7. And that was an awesome show to attend. I loved it. It was really a great kickoff to the wrestling weekend. And, you know, if Ring of Honor is ever in your town, I would definitely say go check them out. It's definitely worth it for the live experience. But unfortunately, I can't recommend buying them, buying the pay-per-view streams on Go Fight Live. Because, or are they still on Go Fight Live? I don't know. But I can't recommend them buying the pay-per-view streams because, fuck-ups like this keep happening with them for whatever reason. I don't know what it is. It just... They just keep fucking up with those pay-per-view streams, and somebody in production needs to be brought in to fix that, because it's really kind of ridiculous how that keeps happening. But if you have a chance to go see a Ring of Honor show live, I highly recommend it, because it is awesome, and I had a blast at that show. It was great, and I love that it was a smaller venue. So it was like between WrestleMania and the Ring of Honor show. I got the big stadium feel, but I also got like the smaller, more intimate Ring of Honor show that provided that as well. So it was really great to get those bases covered, and it was really a wonderful experience, and I really liked it. On Saturday, I went to the Mets game. Citi Field is great. That is a really nice-looking venue for baseball. The reason I bring it up to you guys is that I had gotten a message from James Walsh at WrestlingEpicenter.com that CM Punk was in attendance. So I'm going crazy. I'm like, oh my god, we gotta find Punk. I gotta see Punk and bother him and man crush on him, because that's what I do, because I'm a nerd. I'd heard from somebody else that he threw out the first pitch at the game the day before. So I don't know if Punk was at that game. I doubt it, if he had thrown out the pitch the day before. So I don't know. I got conflicting reports on that. But if anybody wants to tell me if Punk was at the Mets game on Saturday, let me know, because I don't know for sure. But yeah, that was fun to get some baseball in there. I'm not a Mets fan, or not that I hate the Mets. I'm just not a fan. I'm an Orioles fan, in case anybody's wondering. Because I had huge hero worship for Cal Ripken when I was a kid. But it was nice to see a baseball game live, and Citi Field is really, really a nice field. I've got the itch to go to Camden now, because I haven't been to Camden in a few years. I was like, man, I need to go to an Orioles game now. But yeah, so it was nice to get some baseball. And then Saturday night after lunch and dinner and everything, we sat in Eric's apartment and we watched The Mania of WrestleMania, which I'd never seen before, and that was the documentary that the WWE made, which... basically went through the entire history of WrestleMania, and I believe it stops at 26, because I believe that's when the documentary came out. Again, I'd never seen it before, so it really helped get us in the mood to go see WrestleMania the next day. excuse me. Couple things about that documentary that really stood out to me. And this is a problem with all the WWE DVDs, is because WWE's producing them. It has the WWE bullshit factor to it, where it's very biased and they kind of paint themselves like they're flawless or whatever. Like the CM Punk DVD. Love that DVD. I think it's great. If you're a CM Punk fan, pick that shit up. It's really, really good. But there's a couple of things in there, like when they get to the feud with Undertaker in 09... You can tell Punk's pissed off about how that turned out. But then when they interview JR, it's like, I think those matches with Undertaker made CM Punk a bona fide star and made him the man or whatever. And I'm like, that's not what happened at all. That feud almost ruined Punk's career and basically halted him for 2 years. That's just not true. But because you're not allowed to say anything bad about Undertaker... That's how the WWE documentary is going to be presented. So there was some of that in the Mania of WrestleMania. Like they said that Sheamus went up there and said Triple H and Undertaker stole the show at Mania 17. I'm like, no, they really didn't. They really didn't. No, Rock and Austin was the match of the night. Sorry, Sheamus. I know you're Triple H's buddy and everything. What were some other things that they did? That they talked about that really stood out to me. I was shocked at how down they were on Mania 8. They basically talked about how the main event should have been Hogan and Flair. me personally, I never really liked Hogan and Flair's matches, so I saw it like 800 times, so I'm not sorry that it didn't happen at WrestleMania. I think I've said that before. But it was really interesting for them to paint WrestleMania 8 in that light. And they basically made it sound like 8 wasn't that good. And I'm like, I mean, what about Flair and Savage and Piper and Bret? Those matches were awesome. I mean, if 8 has its flaws, sure, but it didn't suck just because Hogan and Flair wasn't on the card. And then at 7, they went on to a long explanation about the Sergeant Slaughter bomb threat, and that's why they had to move out of the bigger venue and into the LA Sports Arena. And I'm like, yeah, but bullshit! No, it was low ticket sales. I'm willing to bet money that that's exactly what it was. That caused that. But again, it's the WWE bullshit factor that you find in these documentaries. The other thing that really struck me, and we actually made a joke out of it, as we were heading into MetLife, they really shit on the Citrus Bowl, which was the venue for WrestleMania 24. They talked about how they were going to be in a much smaller venue, like the smallest venue that Mania's ever hosted, or that Mania's ever been held in. And the Citrus Bowl opened up their doors and said, no, you can come have it here and have it in the big stadium. And they went on, like four or five people talked about how the Citrus Bowl looks like a piece of shit. They didn't say piece of shit, but they were like, it's ugly. I think one of them said it looks like a toilet and like this ugly venue. And it was like, why are they shitting on the Citrus Bowl like this? Like it's like this piece of shit venue. They opened their doors up to you guys and you're shitting on their venue. And then they made it sound, but Vince came in and made it awesome, and it worked out as a nice Mania venue, because Vince made it look awesome. So then it became kind of a joke between Eric and I. It's like, well, MetLife Stadium looks pretty nice, but at least it isn't that piece of shit Citrus Bowl. Fuck them. It was like, they went out of their way to bash the Citrus Bowl in this documentary. I was just like blown away by it. I was like, wow, they did not like being in the Citrus Bowl. They spent more time talking about how ugly the Citrus Bowl was than they did talking about Ric Flair and Shawn Michaels on that same card. It was really, which they almost completely glossed over that actually, but it's just weird. That just struck me as really weird. So that might become a running gag on these videos. It's like, yeah, that venue looked okay, but at least it wasn't that piece of shit Citrus Bowl. God, fuck the Citrus Bowl. But, yeah, the documentary was great in getting us in the mood for WrestleMania and really setting the tone and everything. So the next day, did a little bit of sightseeing. We walked around Central Park and we went to the Guggenheim Museum, which that was always fun. Modern art and wrestling in the same day. I mean, that's, you know, two peas in a pod. That's what you do. If you gotta mix up two things, it's gotta be the Guggenheim and WrestleMania. But yeah, after all that was done, we got on the train, New Jersey Transit, and headed on over to MetLife Stadium. And I was blown away by how big that crowd was. You know, it's really hard to get a feel for how big a crowd is. Getting up to MetLife Stadium and seeing all those people, I was like, whoa, that is a lot of people. And when I heard the final number was 80,000, I was like, yeah, that's about right. The venue looked awesome. Of course, I was in awe because I'm a, you know, Giants fan. So I'm sitting there looking at it. I was like, man, this is where the Giants play football. I gotta come back here because this looks awesome. And a couple of the fans there told me, it's like, oh yeah, this place is awesome for football. It's, yeah, if you're a Giants fan or a Jets fan, this place, you gotta come here for a home game because it's awesome. And I was blown away by how awesome the set looked. I don't know how it looked on TV, and that's going to be a lot of things I'm going to make when I talk about WrestleMania 29. I don't know how it played off on TV. I have not watched it yet. Actually sat down and watched the event. So I don't know how everything came off on TV. So keep that in mind when I'm talking about this. So I don't know how the set looked on TV, but in person, I thought, it's like, man, that's the coolest set they've ever had for WrestleMania. I was like, that, with the Statue of Liberty hovering over the ring, and the Brooklyn Bridge set up, and the Empire State Building that lit up and everything, I was like, man, that set looks awesome. I got so many pictures of the set, because I was just blown away by how awesome it looked. And our seats were great. We were up on the higher section, in the highest point of the arena, or the stadium. But our line of sight, as you could probably see in the pictures, our line of sight was straight down onto the ring, so our visibility was great. Even though they looked small and the ring looked small, our visibility was amazing because we just looked straight down onto the ring and could see the screen and everything. I have no complaints about my seats. My seats were great. And I feel sorry for anybody that had a corner seat, though, because I imagine with those giant poles holding the stage up that visibility wasn't very good, I would imagine. But, man, sitting in section 313, which I have to say, you guys were great. I loved watching WrestleMania with you guys. Very lively bunch. A lot of like-minded individuals went along with the people that I was rooting for the most part, not across the board. But very nice, very friendly, very funny, just excited wrestling fans. And you know, nobody was acting out of control. Nobody was being obnoxious. It was just a nice group of people. So Section 313, I will always remember you guys as being the bunch that I watched WrestleMania 29 with, and you all were great, and I was happy to be in that section and share that experience with all of you, because y'all were great. It was a great section to be in for WrestleMania. And we get into the pre-show, and I loved what they did with the pre-show, where they had so almost like an ESPN or NFL Network setup, where they had JR, Dusty Rhodes, Kofi Kingston, and some other guy. I forgot who it was. I think it was Max Stryker, but I'm not sure. Sitting at like basically a round table and discussing the card and going over everything and analyzing it. And that was great. I was like, wow, they're making it look sports-like. I like stuff like that. That's awesome. All their pre-shows should be like that. That is a pretty awesome setup. And then we got the pre-show match, which was The Miz versus Wade Barrett, which was an okay match. It was basically, it was an acceptable pre-show match, I thought. And they did the title change just to liven the crowd up, I think. And, of course, it was rendered entirely pointless when Barrett just won the title back the next night. So, you know, whatever. but, yeah, it was fine for what it was. It was just a pre-show match. And for that, it was okay. And then we started counting down. The announcers all came out and everything. Cole got booed, of course. Eric and I were the only ones that booed Lawler, I felt like. But you suck at your job, Jerry Lawler. And we wanted it to be known. And unfortunately, nobody went along with us. And JBL came out to a huge ovation as well. And, of course, I cheered the fuck out of him. Because he's like, yeah, he's the best announcer they have, of course. Lillian still looks gorgeous in person. I saw her when I was at SummerSlam 05 a few years ago. It's like, god damn, that was almost 8 years ago. I'm getting old. Actually, it was over 8 years ago, yeah. I keep forgetting, it's not, oh my god, I'm so old. Blah, blah, blah. Whatever. But yeah, Lillian still looks hot. And no, she's not a horse face, Triple H. Okay. And we're all getting excited, we're really lively. And I've heard reports that the crowd sounded dead. We were not. I thought the bunch was very, very lively bunch. And like I said, that crowd that was at Raw, you know, last night, singing songs and chanting everything under the sun, most of them, if not all of them, had to have been at Mania the night before. You know, they had to have been at WrestleMania, so, you know, and I'm telling you, as someone that was there, they were very lively and very responsive to a lot of things. But when I was watching the Mania of WrestleMania, they did talk about that, how the stadium feel is very different because there's no roof. Sound just kind of travels up, and it's harder to hear overall. And I think, you know, hearing the reports of how people were reacting to WrestleMania 29 and basing it on my experience, I feel like, yeah, there must be some truth to that, because I thought the crowd was very energetic and very lively for most of the show. And they were very responsive to a lot of things. What I did find, though, is very hard. Section 313, we were trying to start a lot of weird chants throughout the night. Nothing on par with what you heard on Raw the other night, but we had a few weird ones going, and we couldn't really get any of them to leave our section, and I think a lot of it is just because it's hard to maintain a huge universal chant in a crowd of 80,000 people. But we had some good ones going, and I'll get into those as I talk more and more about the show. So anyway, the show kicks off. They skipped the national anthem, which I thought was really, really weird. And I was actually disappointed by that, because that's always been kind of a nice Mania tradition. Or any sports event, you just expect that. It's part of the, you know, pageantry and the presentation of the whole thing. So I was a little disappointed. They just skipped the national anthem. So I thought that was weird. They had the National Guard. I think it was the National Guard. They had them stand on stage and they acknowledged them and everything. So I'm like, okay, National Anthem coming. And no, they didn't do it. It was really weird. I don't know. I don't have any explanation for that. Again, I don't know how this came off on TV. I don't know what it looked like on TV. We saw on the screen a bunch of the video packages for the matches. The Cena Rock video packages and everything like that. And during the pre-show, they showed us everything like the JR Roundtable. I'm just calling it the JR Roundtable. We saw all that stuff. We saw a couple backstage promos, one that involved Snooki, and of course she got booed. Michael Strahan was there, and that was cool to see him. I didn't get a picture of him, but I was like, yeah, Michael Strahan, my hero. Should have worn my jersey. But we saw all that stuff, so I don't know if they just didn't show us stuff or whatever, but there were no backstage skits or promos or anything, which I don't really have a problem with, because most of the backstage skits they did were terrible. I mean, look at WrestleMania 27. Most of that backstage stuff is just un-fucking-watchable. I tried to I rewatched Mania 27 recently, and I had to skip over a lot of that because it was just painful to watch again. It was like, oh my god, I remember why I was so down on this show, because we got bombarded with all that shit. And but there was none of that here, so I don't know if we just didn't see it, and they aired it on TV, and we just didn't get it. I have no idea. I'm just going by, you know, we just didn't. There must not have been, because I don't think there was, like, too many points where there was dead time where they weren't showing us anything. So, yeah, that was really weird, too. I mean, again, I'm not complaining, because their comedy skits are usually terrible. But that was something that struck me as really interesting as well. And I guess, and of course, we were joking about this as we were in the crowd. There was a helicopter that kept flying overhead. And we kept joking. It's like, wouldn't it be funny if Vince McMahon was in that helicopter and just had a megaphone and just yelled down at us? It's like, you know, Rockin' Cena is the greatest thing ever. Fuck you! And stuff like that. So I'm thinking, what if Vince just said, fuck the national anthem. Rockin' Cena is more important than America. And that is a horrible Vince McMahon impression, but I don't care. But it was funny to think about. So it's funny, they cut out all the backstage skits and everything just to give Rockin' Cena as much time as possible. So that was interesting. Weather was not a problem. It was a little chilly. It started to drizzle a little bit during the opening match, but other than that, there was no problem. And that was a genuine concern of mine. I was like, the weather is going to be a huge fucking, could be the downfall of the show, quite honestly. And but no, it wasn't. It stayed mostly fine. It was a little cold in parts, but other than that, yeah, it stayed mostly okay, and like I said, it drizzled a little bit during the opening match, but other than that, it passed pretty quickly, so weather was not a factor, which is very good, and I was happy with that, because that was something I was genuinely worried about. So getting into the matches, we got The Shield versus Big Show, Randy Orton, and Sheamus, and the one chant that Section 313, always remember Section 313, we were awesome. The only chant we seemed to get going was a Shield chant early on. That was really the only one that really seemed to carry over into most of the crowd, because the crowd really seemed to be into the Shield. And I'd say I really liked this match. I thought it was a pretty exciting, action-packed opener, and I really liked it. And I was so happy that the Shield got the win, because them losing that match would have been so anticlimactic and stupid. Of course, again, I point out my whole thing of how there really is no direction with these guys. It's just, okay, let's find three baby faces to throw at them once a month for a pay-per-view match, and that's all. Eventually, they're going to lose, and that's going to be the whole direction with them. Nobody knows what their motives are. It's to fight injustice. Nobody knows what that means. And they just fight, you know, random baby faces every month. And that was pretty much confirmed on Raw, where they went after Undertaker, and it's going to be Undertaker, Kane, and Daniel Bryan. And granted, Undertaker being thrown in with those guys does elevate it a bit, But it's still kind of the same thing. It was like, you're just shuffling out baby faces. It's just this revolving door of baby faces to fight the Shield with no real direction or purpose behind anything. It's just really just confusing. I don't know. But overall, I really like this match. I thought it was a pretty good opener. I thought the Shield came off really, really well. And my love for Dean Ambrose continues. It's really, really good. And, of course, Big Show turned heel after the match. And, by the way, the wrestling fans' equivalent to counting sheep is counting how many times Big Show has turned face or heel. Because, my God, if I go back to his WCW days and count all the way to now, or even if I just start with his WWE days and go from there, I could sit here all day and count the number of times he's turned, and I'd be asleep, because it's the equivalent of counting sheep. There's just so goddamn many times. And it's one of the reasons nobody gives a shit about Big Show anymore, because it's like, oh, God, he's always either a smiling doofus, big huggable teddy bear baby face, or he's a monster. And we've seen it all, and that's why I groan whenever they turn Big Show heel. It's like, oh, here we go again. And there's just... it's just annoying, and... That's the kind of the story of Big Show's career. There's no consistency with him, and he's never been booked all that well as a giant. Except, honestly enough, in WCW. That was the one time in his career where him as a giant, it was like, okay, yeah, they kept him pretty strong as a monster, I thought. Despite, you know, the fact that he was green as goose shit, and you know, there were some other things creatively that they were doing that were stupid, like the Dungeon of Doom. They did a really good job of presenting him as a monster. And he didn't get slammed as much as he does now, so that's another thing. But yeah, I babbled on long enough. I really liked the opening match. I thought that was really good, and I was really happy that Shield got the win, and so was most of the audience. Then the second match was Ryback versus Mark Henry. Did not like this match. This match was fucking horrible. I would even go as far to say it was the worst match I saw this weekend. Even worse than the Roderick Strong match, Mr. Unimpressive, or even the dark match at the Ring of Honor show with Konga. I was like, God damn, this match is fucking horrible. Ryback and Henry went out there and had like the most boring fucking match ever. It was so bad, and the fans were about as receptive to it as you would imagine. There were some Goldberg chants early on. There were sexual chocolate chants early on. But by the end, people were just like, all right, can we just move along here? This is getting pretty bad. And it was a bad match. It was really just dull, boring, uninteresting, and like the, you know, by far the worst match on the show, without question. That said, I did like the finish where Mark Henry crashed on top of Ryback during the shell shock and got the pin. I thought that was a really creative finish, and I wish there were more finishes like that rather than just the constant, you know, kick out of finishers left and right and then just hit another finisher for the win. I do like that kind of creativity. I remember one of my favorite finishes ever was Sting and Vader at the, I think it was their Great American Bash match, where Sting was going for the Stinger Splash. He came off, and Vader moved out of the way, and Sting hit the ring post on the Stinger Splash, and that's how Vader got the win. And I was like, yeah, that's actually a really good finish. I think that's, you know, and it really creates the impression that the match can end at any time, and not just when the finishers hit. So, yeah, I like the finisher. Ryback hit the shell shock on Henry after the match, which was a nice visual, but overall, I was like, yeah, this match was way too long and way too boring, and awful, awful, awful fucking match. I don't know if it's, like, you know, gonna crack my list of the WrestleMania video I had, ranking the worst WrestleMania matches. I don't know if it's that bad. I probably wouldn't say it's that bad, but it was still a really bad match, and I did not care for it that much. Next up was the tag team title match. It was Team Hell No versus Ziggler and Biggie Langston. Biggie Langston looked okay in there. They kept him in a very limited role, which is fine. The tag match itself was fine. It was a solid match all around. I enjoyed watching Ziggler and Daniel Bryan go at it. I love that they teased the 18-second Kiss of Death spot with AJ at the beginning of the match. I thought that was a nice little callback to last year's Mania. Daniel Bryan was insanely over with the crowd. He was probably the most universally liked wrestler on the show. Everybody else was like split. You know, Punk and Taker, the fans were split. Triple H and Brock, fans were split. I could go through the entire card, and they were split on certain guys. Daniel Bryan was probably the most universally liked guy on the card. And I have to talk about this guy. There was a guy that was walking around the upper sections I think from his accent, I think he was from England. I'm not sure. But he looked like Daniel Bryan. He wore a shirt, wore wrestling tights in that cold. I was like, that motherfucker must have been cold. But he was like this really funny guy that was walking around. And there were a lot of guys that came dressed up as wrestlers, but his was by far the best. There was a Ric Flair. There was a Hogan. I saw a Hogan. Some guys dressed up like the Bushwhackers walking around. But that dude was the best because he was so weird and funny. And he was just walking around saying, hashtag 5-second poses. I have no idea what that means. But people were taking pictures with it. I obviously put a picture of him at the start of this video. But he was great. A really funny guy. And Daniel Bryan brings a lot of interesting people to the show. And actually, I got to bring this up too. After the show was done and we were waiting to get on the train, there was this drunk guy in a Daniel Bryan t-shirt that was being taken away by the cops and being escorted off the train. So I don't know if he caused a ruckus or what, but he was clearly drunk. And of course, his departure was treated with, yes, yes, yes. And that was the last major chant of the night. was a drunk guy in a Daniel Bryan t-shirt being taken off the train, which was really, really, really funny. Although I felt bad for the guy. I'm like, man, how's he going to get home if he's being escorted off the train? I don't know. I hope drunk Daniel Bryan guy got home safely. That's all I'm going to say. If anybody knows, please let me know because I'm kind of worried about him. I kind of felt bad for laughing at him too, but... so yeah, Daniel Bryan's got a lot of interesting people that like him. And, of course, fans were chanting yes, yes, yes all throughout the show. Or all throughout the match, anyway. And even before the show started. The chants that were going on before the show started were yes chants and the dueling let's go Cena, Cena sucks chants. So yeah, again, lively bunch. But this match was fine. It was pretty much a standard tag match with Team Hell No getting the win. It was pretty solid and, just a good match all around. It was nice to see Daniel Bryan actually have a good WrestleMania match after getting screwed over the last couple of years. And it was nice to see Ziggler have a good one, too, because he's never really had a good WrestleMania match either. So, it was, you know, it wasn't anything that special. It was just a pretty standard tag match. But, I mean, that's way better treatment than most of them have gotten, you know, at WrestleMania in the past, obviously. So, yeah, this match was fine. I had no problem with how it turned out. Then we got Chris Jericho versus Fandango. Fandango had an awesome entrance with the dancers. The theme song did not break out, obviously, with the fans singing the theme song. That was a Raw thing. And I kind of wish it had broken out in WrestleMania because that was awesome. But man, this match was kind of the opposite of the Ryback-Henry match where I thought the match was fine. I thought it was a perfectly acceptable match, a good match. And then they botched the finish, and I was like, that's going to knock it down a few pegs for some people, and I was kind of hoping, I hope it doesn't make people think less of Fandango, because I still think the talent has a lot of potential, and I do love the character overall, and obviously with his theme song catching on the way it has, that's going to give him a lot to do as well. So yeah, I thought the match was fine, I thought it was a pretty good match overall. The crowd was really into Jericho, so that obviously helped. And I thought they had a nice athletic match. Jericho dominated most of the match, which I thought was a little strange. But overall, I thought Fandango came off really well, except for that finish, which I think knocks the match down a few pegs. And that's a shame, because I thought, I was hoping for a stronger debut for him. And it, like I said, it was fine, except for the finish. And so, again, it's kind of the opposite of Ryback-Henry, where that match had a really good finish, but it was a really shitty match. But, yeah, I thought the match was good overall, still, even with the finish. It just kind of came off not as well as it should have because of the way it ended. Now, to add in some of my thoughts of Monday Night Raw into this discussion, how it ties into the more undercard matches for WrestleMania, I do have to comment on the Sheamus-Randy Orton match that happened on Raw this week, because I have never seen a crowd completely no-sell a match more than that match. It was just the most unbelievable thing I've ever seen. I've never seen an uninterested crowd show their lack of interest in such a spectacular way with all the wacky chants they had going. It was like they were on cocaine or some hallucinogenic drug that I don't even know about. It was just really wacky and weird, and I really, really loved it. I'm not sure if Sheamus and Randy Orton is, like, the worst match of the year or, like, a match of the year contender, or, like, my favorite match in the last 10 years because of how the crowd reacted to it. It was just so goddamn weird. It was so funny and weird, and I really enjoyed that. And like I said, you know, Fandango's theme song being sung was hilarious. If this is something that catches on, I hope that they keep it just to Fandango, and I hope that the fans are smart enough not to do that for everybody else, because that would get... It'll become like the what chant. It'll just get annoying after a while. So, if you're gonna do that, keep it just a Fandango, and I think we'll be okay. We'll be fine. Any other things I need to talk about? No, I don't think so. I think we're good. Okay, getting back to WrestleMania, that was pretty much the undercard for WrestleMania. And then we got P. Diddy's performance or whatever, which I did not see because I went straight to the concession stand, got me some cheese fries, and that was that. I didn't see it, and I don't care that I missed it. It was a perfect, you know, bathroom break or food break material. That's what the Diddy performance is, and that's what all musical performance all. I mean, do you know what I did for Beyonce's Super Bowl halftime show this year? I took I was invited to two Super Bowl parties, so I was at the first one for the first half and the second one for the second half. So Beyonce, what you were was the drive in between party one to party two. And that's what musical performance at big shows like this are to me. It's just, oh, it's a break. I can go off and get on the phone and or take a piss or a shit or go get food and get my cheese fries. And that's what this was to me. And a lot of people thought the same way because a lot of people got up and went to go get food or go to the bathroom or whatever. So that was that. And then we're right back to the wrestling. We got the World Heavyweight title match between Jack Swagger and Alberto Del Rio, which nobody is talking about, oddly enough. Like, that's the one match that I've yet to hear anybody comment on that match in any kind of significant way. Like, in the passing comments I've heard about WrestleMania, I've heard a lot of comments about the main events and some comments here and there about the undercard matches, but for some reason, nobody is talking about this match. It wasn't a bad match. It was solid. It was all right for what it was. It wasn't particularly memorable or anything. The major thing that stood out to me was that, again, Section 313 were awesome, but it wasn't just us. Lots of people were chanting, "We want Ziggler," or "Cash it in," or, you know, other stuff like that, and we were sitting there waiting for Ziggler to come out. Like, okay, the second Alberto Del Rio got the win, we were like, okay, where's Ziggler? And I had my camera, I was holding it, I was like, I want to see Ziggler come out, where's Ziggler? And he didn't come out, I was like, well, that sucks. And the crowd actually booed when the segment faded to black, and we moved on to the next thing. I was like, wow, that's really shitty. I was like, come on. And then the next night on Raw, what happens? And, well, before I go to that, I remember I turned to Eric, and I said, you know what? Ziggler's probably going to cash in tomorrow night on Raw just to piss us off. And, you know, of course, when we're not there, it happens. And sure enough, that's exactly what happened on Monday Night Raw. Ziggler cashes in, and the crowd goes crazy, and we get the big title win. And I'm just sitting there like, why couldn't they have done that at WrestleMania? I mean, okay, I still hate that the world title exists, and I don't think it should exist, but if it has to, and if you're going to keep doing these shock, out-of-nowhere Money in the Bank title wins, which I think have been long played out, if you're going to keep these things around, at least put it on the best guy, which is Ziggler. So I'm like, okay, happy that Dolph's the champion. Yeah, I wish they built him up better, but again, that's part of the problem of the Money in the Bank system and how they handle it. It's just, I'm just sitting there like, you know, why didn't you do this at WrestleMania where this would have been a bigger deal? And it actually would have been a major headline for WrestleMania. And that's actually going to tie into a point I'm going to make at the end of this and when I talk about the show as a whole. But I'm like, why didn't they just do the cash-in at WrestleMania? When it would have been a bigger deal and the crowd would have popped huge. And at the very least, you would have had that Mania headline like, okay, major WrestleMania moment. First Money in the Bank cash-in in WrestleMania history. And I don't know why they did that, but oh well. It would have been a huge thing coming out of WrestleMania, I think. And of course, I'm selfish. I wanted to see Ziggler win the title. So, you know, when I heard, because I got a text message while I was on the bus ride back, when I heard that Ziggler cashed in, I was like, those motherfuckers. Those motherfuckers. But anyway, that was that. They moved into the first major main event of the night, which was The Undertaker versus CM Punk with the streak on the line, and the crowd was red hot for this match. I mean, this was the match that everybody was waiting for, and it was obvious. Crowd was split, but I would say it was more in favor of CM Punk than it was for Taker. I mean, they were nuts for Punk. And that was awesome to see. Of course, my section was a little split, but it was more for Punk, I think, overall. And we all knew that Punk was going to lose. I mean, it's a foregone conclusion that Taker goes over at Mania, and especially this year, where I didn't think there was any question that he was going over. But it's still, I mean, the crowd being as into it as they were was very nice to see. And there was a lot of excitement and chanting and cheering and everything else. And it was just a wonderful experience from that aspect. And I have to say, that match was awesome. Again, I don't know how it played off on TV, but I thought Punk and Taker had an amazing match. I would say, at the very least, it's better than the last two Taker-Triple H matches at WrestleMania. And they did so many great things here. My favorite spot was the Anaconda Vice spot, where Undertaker sat up and just stared Punk down. That was an awesome visual. I would love to know who came up with that spot, because it looked amazing. And I was like, wow, that looked really, really cool. And, you know, again, we all knew that Taker was going to win. And there was no point in the match where I really felt like, oh my god, this streak is over, like I did at 21 with Randy Orton. And even then, I'm like, okay, you look back at that match, that was before all the insanity where Undertaker kicked out of every goddamn thing possibly imaginable. So even that match, if they were to repeat that spot somehow, I would even think he's kicking out. Because it's just, that's just the way it is. That's Taker at Mania. However, I was really happy that CM Punk finally got, like, a really, really great WrestleMania match. Because, like I said, I wasn't that impressed with the Jericho match last year, and he's never really been given the opportunity to do that prior to that. I mean, yeah, his match with Orton was good. It wasn't anything special, though. And yeah, he'd been in three straight Money in the Banks, and those are always fun, but... And yeah, he won two of those, but he's sharing the spotlight with seven other people, and it's just a car wreck with people diving off of ladders and shit. I wanted Punk to have that really great one-on-one WrestleMania match. Sort of like what Edge did at 22 with Foley, when he had that hardcore match with Foley. I was like, that kind of did a lot for Edge, where I was like, yeah, he'd had all the TLC matches and the Money in the Bank match before this, but this was like his big singles match at WrestleMania, and his big match. And that's what this was for Punk in my eyes. It was like he finally got like a great WrestleMania match, and this was a great match. I loved it. It was my favorite match of the weekend. The crowd was totally invested in everything that they did. It was great all around, great action. A lot of creativity with the spots. What is with Punk and announce tables lately, where they either break too soon or they don't break at all? And of course, I think it probably hurt more that the table didn't break on that huge elbow drop spot. But yeah, I can't say enough good things about this match. It was outstanding. Even though Taker won and like, yeah, streak continues, I thought it did a lot for Punk, and I was glad to see Taker give Punk a lot as well. Like, he let him kick out of the tombstone, which I thought was huge, and that puts Punk on a pretty elite level. And this was an elite-level match. This was definitely a WrestleMania-caliber match, and definitely the highlight of the night for me. And, you know, if nothing else coming out of this WrestleMania, I got to see that match at a WrestleMania live in person. And that was awesome. And I think anybody that was in attendance that night will tell you that that was definitely the match of the night. Then we get to the next main event, which was Brock Lesnar versus Triple H. Now, I'm reading a lot of things where people are saying that the crowd was dead for this match. And if you've read those reports and if you saw the match, you know, I don't know how it played off on TV, but I'm going to sit here and tell you that the reports are absolutely true. The reports are 100% true. We were totally dead for this match. And here's exactly what it was. I read the review, I think it was Caldwell's review at PW Torch, and he said something like, oh, well, people didn't know how Punk and Taker was going to end, and they knew how Brock and Triple H was going to end, and that's why they weren't as invested in it. And I'm like, well, That's not true, based on the people that I talked to. We all knew that Taker was going to win. We just loved Punk, and that's what that was where the excitement came from there. Brock and Triple H was more up in the air with most people, because, okay, is Triple H going to get his win back, or is he going to get his big retirement send-off that he wants? We didn't know. We just didn't give a shit. And we just didn't care about the feud that much. And Punk and Taker wore us out so much. I'll be honest, I had a massive headache after Punk and Taker, because I was just screaming and hooting and hollering and going just nuts and chanting like a mad person like everybody else in the arena. And my voice was dead after Punk and Taker. We basically put an entire pay-per-view's worth of energy into that one match. And, you know, even the entrances for that match we went nuts for. Like, Living Color coming out and performing for Punk, that was great. I thought they sounded really good anyway. And it was, you know, we were so excited, so pumped, and so just pleased with how that match turned out, even though a lot of us were rooting for Punk, that by the time Brock and Triple H rolled around, we just didn't have the energy. We were just like, we were just dead. And we started talking to each other, like, at least in my section, good old 313. We were just talking about shit. He's like, yeah, Punk and Taker was awesome, wasn't it? Yeah, that match was great. It was awesome. It was great. And this is where we started to come up with some really weird chants, because, and we had some weird chants throughout the night that didn't really catch on throughout the arena. Like, we tried to start an end the street chant during Punk and Taker. And it came off, I think it caught on in our section, but it didn't really last or make it throughout the entire arena. But I mean, there was so much chanting and screaming going on during that match that it was, you know, that wasn't really a problem. But, during this one, we started chanting, okay, when Lesnar hit the F5 and Triple H kicked out, Eric said, it's like, oh, it's all right, Lesnar has his specials built up. Obviously referencing the wrestling video games, and, he has his specials built up, he can just hit another one. And so, Section 313 started chanting, press L2, press L2, press L2, and that was definitely the goofiest chant that we came up with all night. And of course it didn't carry out throughout the arena, but I wish it had, because that was a creative one, and I really like that. But, yeah, we also started chanting when Triple H was locking on the Kimura lock, and he had locked it in like two or three times, and Lesnar kept breaking it. Lesnar wasn't moving, which was what allowed Triple H to keep locking it on. So we started chanting, move your arm, move your arm. Because our section was more for Brock than it was for Triple H. And, you know, because, you know, Triple H, who gives a shit. But overall, we were just not into this match. And a large part of it was because because Taker and Punk was so exciting and so good that we just didn't have the strength for this one. We just kind of were just worn out for this match. And of course, Triple H wins. Lottie fucking da. I mean, that's a real great monster you got there. He's, you know, he's had three matches and he's 1-2, and the one match he won was against the guy that he just lost to. So, yeah, a real dominant monster you got there. And also Triple H could get his win back. What a fucking waste. And it's like, it's nice to know you've completely ruined Brock Lesnar and made his return completely pointless. So, yay, good for you. We did pop for Sean, if nothing else. We did do that, but other than that, we didn't care. And the match wasn't completely horrible. It just, it did pick up in the closing minutes a little bit. But again, it's just like, we were dead because of Taker Punk, and then Triple H winning was just met with groans. And that's just how that is, I guess. But yeah, what else? Then we had the Hall of Fame segment. We popped big for Bruno. We booed Triple H. I mean, we popped for pretty much everybody, but, did I call Donald Trump Triple H? I don't know. I'm getting fucked up. I've been babbling for way too long. I need to stop doing these long videos, but we booed Donald Trump bad, and we pretty much popped huge for everybody else, especially Bruno. And I was sitting there, man, like, man, I got to see Bruno Sammartino live. That's really awesome. Cause he was my dad's favorite. I mean, Bruno was to my dad what Hulk Hogan was to me. I mean, he was just like the personification of wrestling when I was a kid. And that's what Bruno was to my father's generation. So to see Bruno live, I mean, that's a legend right there. Bruno Sammartino is a legend. And I feel that the word legend is thrown around way too loosely, but that guy, that dude's a legend. And for him to get that kind of reaction, just to see him live, was really awesome for me. And that was another major highlight for me, getting to, just to see Bruno Sammartino in person. Keep in mind, I didn't go to the Hall of Fame, so I didn't see his induction speech or anything. I just saw him stand on the stage. And that was enough. I was like, wow, that was, I got to see Bruno Sammartino. That was really, really cool. And, yeah, so the Hall of Fame segment was nice, as always. And then we get to the main event. We booed the fuck out of Cena, which, of course, I mean, that's what you would expect. And we were not into this match much at all. And it wasn't because we were tired, because I felt like Brock and Triple H gave us enough of a rest between Taker and Punk in the main event. That was the popcorn match. But we just, people just didn't care. It was like, look, we saw this last year, and it wasn't that great last year. And it got a boring chant, which I know, that had to have gotten onto TV. For all the weird chants that we tried to start that didn't get on, that one had to have. We actually, when Cena made his entrance, our section, again, good old 313, started a please turn heel chant, which didn't carry out throughout the arena, but, you know, it was, you know, it just was familiar territory. We'd seen this already. And, of course, Eric had another good one-liner where he said, "That'll teach you to take Punk out of the main event." And and that was while the boring chant was going on. But, you know, so again, we were kind of just sitting there talking to each other. Like, yeah, Punk Taker was awesome, wasn't it? And we weren't that interested in the match. And then out of nowhere, they kept kicking out of finishers left and right. And I should note, when Rock kicked out of the first AA, it was met with nothing. It was just, nobody gave a shit, because we're just conditioned to think, it's like, all right, they're going to kick out of 20 finishers here, because that's how it goes at Mania. So that was really funny how that worked out. But, you know, all of a sudden, towards the end of the match, the last few minutes or so, it got really good, because they kicked out of so many finishers. I was like, well, fuck, I don't know what the finish is going to be. So, all right, I'm invested now, just to see what you cook up with for the finish. And after Rock had kicked, I think Rock ended up kicking out of like 3 AAs. I'm not sure. I lost count. To be honest, they might as well have been 20 finishers that were kicked out of during this match. And they did some cool things. I like that they repeated the people's elbow spot from last year. And I like that Rock fell into the same trap as the people's elbow spot from last year. I like that they... So there were some nice callbacks and things like that. But when Rock had kicked out of, like, his second or third AA, Eric had, again, had a great line. Eric is amazingly funny, by the way. I gotta throw that out there. He said something like, "You have no choice, Cena! You have to turn heel! You can't beat him any other way! Pay off the shield! Do whatever you have to do!" to beat him. And then, of course, after a few counters, Cena hit like what felt like his 20th AA and got the win. And, of course, did not turn heel, and Rock and Cena became best buddies after the match. And that was greeted with boos, because it was like, whatever. He's never turning heel. And it's like, you know, it was so funny that Ryback turned heel, or turned heel. I use that loosely because, you know, he got cheered for beating up Cena because that crowd hated Cena so much. But it's amazing that they will literally turn anybody heel except John Cena. And this was probably their best opportunity to do it. They didn't do it, and it's just like, wow, they're never going to turn that guy heel. It's just, they're never going to do it. They're never going to pull the trigger on it. And if they eventually do, it'll probably be when it's way too late and nobody gives a shit. So, I didn't think the match was terrible. It started off terrible, but they were able to kind of repair the mess. And the closing minutes were at least really exciting, but it's just like that whole thing where it's like, okay, status quo maintained, Cena wins for the 80th time and nothing changes, and he gets his win over Rock, hooray, I'll pretend to care. And and that was kind of the major problem with this WrestleMania. And I referenced it when I talked about Ziggler not cashing in at Mania. There were no major happenings at this show. And that was part of the problem with it. And I think that's why a lot of the show is being greeted with a lot of negativity. Because, think of all the things they could have done. Nothing really happened with the Shield. There was no major advancement with the Shield. They didn't lose, which, thank God. But they didn't really do anything huge with them that was like a major headline. What else? Ziggler didn't cash in his money in the bank. That should have been a huge WrestleMania moment that they should have done. Didn't happen. The streak didn't end, which, again, we all knew that wasn't happening. But, again, that's another thing. It's just the status quo. Taker wins at Mania. Triple H wins for some... just for the sake of getting his win back. Groans, groans, groans all around. And he does it in, like, a totally mediocre match as well. It's like, hooray, Triple H gets a Mania win. And great, Brock Lesnar's ruined. John Cena wins the title for the 857th time, and the show ends, of course, with ba-ba-da-ba, and he holds the title up, and what the fuck ever. And that was really the major problem with WrestleMania 19, is that there were no major instances or no major moments. It was just kind of... they just put on a standard wrestling show where they maintained the status quo. Did I hate the show? No, I was there live, and it was a very fun experience. I wouldn't change that for anything. I loved being there. I loved the whole experience. I loved being with that crowd. I loved being in Section 313. And I loved being with my friend Eric and sharing this awesome experience. That's something that can never be taken away. I was like, okay, that's a bucket list thing. I was at WrestleMania, and that was amazing. So, I loved the whole overall experience. I loved the whole weekend. I loved it. The only thing I hated was the bus ride back, but, you know, whatever. And I love sharing it with you guys. I loved sitting here talking about how much I had fun at WrestleMania. I just feel like this WrestleMania was obviously heavily flawed, though. Again, I don't know how it came off on TV, but... you know, the big joke among us coming out of the show was like, yep, status quo maintained, here we go. Yeah, yep, status quo. Cena wins again, hooray. Triple H wins again, hooray. Undertaker streak continues, hooray. It was a lot of that. It was just nothing major changed and no major instances. But you got a few good matches out of it. One awesome match in Punk and Taker. I will go as far to say that's probably my favorite match that I've ever seen live. I will go that far. I really loved being in the crowd for that match, and that was worth it to me. That was worth the whole experience, just to see that one match. Then, of course, I wish I had stayed the extra day and gone to Raw the next night, because that would have been a hoot to be in that crowd when they were acting so weird. Monday rolled around, and I did some sightseeing in Manhattan. I got to the top of the Empire State Building and took some awesome pictures. But other than that, I just took the long bus ride home, and that was it. But it was an awesome weekend, and I loved it. Loved the whole thing. WrestleMania 29, it obviously has some heavy flaws, but I love being there, and I'm very appreciative for the experience, and I'm glad that I got to be a part of it. So I noticed a comment on my last video saying, oh, poor NYG, he must have been tortured at that event. It's like, no, I wasn't tortured. It was, and I pretty much said that in the video, regardless of how the show turns out, it will be a fun experience, just to say I was at a WrestleMania in that venue, at MetLife Stadium. It was awesome. I loved the whole experience, and I had a lot of fun, regardless of whatever flaws the show had. I had a lot of fun, and I was a happy wrestling fan all weekend between the Ring of Honor show and WrestleMania. I thought I had a very good weekend, and it was great. So I hope you're still here after all this babbling. I was like, man, I gotta cut it out with the long videos. I'm sick and tired of these 30, 40, 50 hour and a half long videos. I'm just, my voice is almost dead. And they're killing me. They really are. So probably next time you see me, my next video is gonna be like 10 minutes long, maybe less. But that'll be it for the long videos. And thank you to everybody who really appreciated my WrestleMania videos. But I knew I was going to WrestleMania, and I thought, man, this is going to be an awesome experience. So I got to really go the extra mile with the videos that I do and the WrestleMania-related material that I cover. So I put a lot of effort into those. And even though the videos were insanely long, and I can't imagine anybody sitting through me talking this long. If anybody's still here listening to this one, I'll be amazed. I had a blast all weekend, and I do appreciate all the kind comments and the support for my videos. And the weekend totally lived up to my expectations, and I loved it. So I'll be back probably later this week with another video. I need to talk TNA again. I haven't talked TNA since lockdown, really. And I didn't see the X Division pay-per-view that they did, so I might check that out as well. I've got to check out WrestleMania at some point, too, just to get a feel for how it came off on TV. But yeah, that was my WrestleMania weekend experience. You know, here's looking forward to next year. I kind of want to go to WrestleMania 30 now. See, I had such fun. I was like, man, I want to go back next year. But hopefully they're not doing Cena Rock, you know, part 5 by that point. They might squeeze in 2 more rematches in between. Who knows? But, yeah, WrestleMania 29, the whole weekend, awesome, awesome experience. I loved it. And, yeah, I'll be back later this week with another video. So until then, everybody, later.